1960 what? And it ain't right now, damn it. How you doing, Rezzy?
You ain't never lied about that. Happy Saturday.
I'm just saying. I'm so glad to see you, though. Good morning, sunshine.
It's glad. It was good to be seen. Good morning back.
How about that? Mm-hmm. How about that? So, today, obviously, we're going to have a special show. But before we get to all of that, I just really want to check in with you and find out, how are you doing?
I am taking it day by day, and today I am doing well. Woke up in deep prayer and meditation for friends and family who have lost loved ones. You, of course, are included in that mix. And just anybody who is out there on the front lines today with the protests and, you know, just centering, you know, myself as I start to nourish today. You know, so I take my little mineral regimen, and then I pop on with you on Saturdays, and in that order.
You know. Well, I hope, and you know what I'm going to do, and I haven't been really doing it. I've normally been waiting until our guest comes on to add the Facebook page, but somehow I feel like there'll be more talk than music, and I think they shut it down on Facebook because of the music. So okay. I just added the Facebook page, and as we see people come on and stream on from Facebook, we'll remind them to join us via YouTube.
Okay.
Which is the preferred platform. So if you're listening to this in real time, or if you are listening to this at some later point, please go to WJBR Internet Radio and subscribe.
Thank you.
Well, I'm glad you're feeling good. Troy's scheduled to come on later on, maybe about noon, to chat with us about Miss Bonnie Pointer, who, you know, I just feel bad. I wasn't able to edit everything the way I would have liked to, especially the show that we did live here.
Mm-hmm.
I just didn't have, there just wasn't enough time, and even up to the last minute, and I apologize, I came on a little late today, because I was still trying to chop it up, and it just didn't work out. Good morning, Misty. Hey, Pops. I don't even know if I said good morning to Pops.
Hey, good morning, Pops. Good morning, Misty. Misty made an amazing dinner last night, and we did some friends and family. Just for some family love, basically, you know.
Nice.
They're part of my wellness tribe, you know. And she made an amazing meal for us yesterday. So shout out to Misty Dawn.
That's beautiful. The tribe is essential.
Tell me about it, man. Talk about community, you know. And that's part of what I was, that was in my meditation today, my thought. Because, you know, You have your biological family, and you have your chosen family, and you know, under the auspices of community, you know, you get an amazing luxury of picking people in your immediate likeness, you know,
absolutely,
and building and keeping you lifted and. You know, and of course, we're the giggle bunch, too. We get together. We just have a whole lot of laughs and keeping each other lifted. And that is so incredibly important right now to have your tribe. So shout out to my tribe who keeps me lifted.
Absolutely. I just realized that I did not post the flyer that I did about a half an hour ago on Instagram. So I'm trying to do that now. So forgive me if I'm a little distracted, but you're absolutely right. The tribe is essential.
No worries. No worries at all.
I'm not going to write a whole big thing except join us, damn it.
Yeah, well, man. I was trying to get my little groove on too, but you know, time didn't allow it. Because I looked up and the only thing I really had time for is to make some toast to come to brunch today in the basement with you. So I wanted to, you know, play that Pointer Sisters joint from Car Wash, you know, Believe in Something.
Oh yeah, yeah, yeah.
That gets my, fact, you know.
Let's see, you know, let me just play a little bit of that while I, I'm glad you mentioned it.
Man, that's, you know, it's just so, you could sit and just listen to the legacy of Bonnie Pointer and the Pointer Sisters music all day.
Oh, absolutely.
All day, you know?
Absolutely. Absolutely.
Shout out to Oakland.
Oh, yeah. Oakland is fire, right? You got the Pointer Sisters. You got Raphael Sadiq, Dawn Robinson, Terrell.
Oh, man. Yeah, it's just so many. Yeah. That ain't all. You know, Oakland, the Bay Area. Oakland, man, they had a lot of fire coming out of Oakland.
Mr. Lenny Williams.
No, it's spelt bread pops, which is my not the sourdough, the regular whole wheat spelt, which is amazing. It just like melts in your mouth. You keep it frozen. I'm gonna have to, when I do eat bread, I prefer spelt bread. So good, and it's so light, and I don't feel like I have a rock in my stomach,
Well, that's important.
Yes.
That's how I feel sometimes when I try to cook, especially spaghetti. I don't know why.
Really?
Yeah, I don't, I'm not a good cook. I just make myself sick, so I don't do that. I'm hoping that Loretta from Connecticut actually joins us today because I actually was able to pull out a little clip of her and Bonnie Pointer speaking. So I hope she does.
Nice.
Call so that we can let her hear that,
Yeah.
But in the meanwhile, let's play You Gotta Believe, and I can calm my brain down a little bit because I just didn't. So Let's do that. I'm glad you brought that song up, Rezzy.
That's one of my faves.
You're listening to WJBR Internet Radio, Brunch in the Basement with Javon and Therese. Yes, I have been so inspired, Pop, to eat a little better.
Yes.
Wonder who's been inspiring me, Sunshine.
Oh man, so many. And Pop is having green tea with a slice of toast and organic peanut butter. All right now, Poppy Chulo.
All right, so you know what? I want to get this started. I'm not going to just wait because of the way I was able to chop up some earlier broadcasts with her. I always, you know, this is just the way I do things. I start at the beginning. I don't know if you notice when I interview people, I like to start with, you know, when they were a kid and then work up to where we are now and, you know, how they are. That's just my chain of thought. I want to give them a chance to tell their story, and I start like that. And so with Bonnie Pointer, and I have to say, she was one of the very first artists that I actually got to interview who had some level of recognition. She wasn't the first. Obviously, I've said it many times, it was Melba Moore. And then came Sarah Dash and so forth and so on.
Legends.
Yeah, you know what? And it's the way it happened is like they just kind of fell into my lap. Like, this is what I was supposed to be doing. And now I know this is what we are supposed to be doing. You understand what I'm saying? So, you know, I feel blessed and fortunate and really, really fortunate to have been able to spend some time speaking with Bonnie Pointer. And of all the Pointer sisters, I think that she was the right one for me. Okay. I used to have this image of them, and let me know, Rez, if you felt this way about them too, that they were proper, but not proper, because when you see them in
what's proper, because then that make me
right. I know that's a bad word, but like sophisticated. They were women that you were supposed to be very respectful towards. They wouldn't do or say bad words. There was something about them that had a bit of class. Let me just say that.
Okay. Well, I'll put it like this. I will say that when I was growing up and became aware, like the Pointer Sisters, just the idea of, first of all, the regality is the first word that comes to mind when I think about the Pointer Sisters. And then as early as some of the shows that we were watching that were household staples in the Black community, i.e. Soul Train and, you know, and magazines like Ebony and Jet and, you know,
Right On magazine.
Right On, you know, they were staples there. And obviously with us our entire life, you know, and my immediate peer group. So seeing women that were all sisters, you know, all regal and just amazing to watch. All of those images back there were important for a young Black girl growing up. You know, you had to see it. And because there were so few and far between, you know, that got the exposure that the Pointer Sisters did, you know, you can remember those images, you know, very, very vividly, because, you know, you just became in awe with seeing them. And then, of course, listening to their music, you know, you just, you know, quite like a lot of the musical families today, like when you see the Pointer Sisters, the Jones Girls, you know, all of those legendary faces. I remember, like, my first on-screen love was Pam Grier, you know, and Tamara Dobson, and, you know, all of those. And those are the women that I gravitated toward, you know, with like, you know, kind of eyes, because, you know, they were larger than life and they were beautiful. They were strong. The Jane Kennedys, you know, just all of those lovely and legendary and just beautiful images, you know, Pat Cleveland back in the day, like, you know what I mean? Like, just so many amazing, and you had to, and unfortunately, They had this thing that is, you know, that they, with so many of us, we weren't allowed to have more than one at a time, you know? So, and it was always like the exception, but shout out to the women that were the exception, because they held that at the time with such dignity, class, and poise, you know? And when I mean by class, it's just like, you know, we had just, I don't believe in the classing system, because it kind of subscribes itself to the European or parliament type, you know, situations. But I can say that our queens, you know, represented us well. The Diane Carrolls, you know, just the amazing, amazing, beautiful, graceful, as we all are, you know, in our own right. There's some great, you know, and then speaking of Diane Carroll, her capacity to take us from Julia to Claudine, you know, and still carry that grace. She was one of the first that represented women from the hood in a way that did not depict them as you know, just beneath someone's shoe. You know, she held Claudine down, you know, and Claudine had grace, and Claudine the presence she brought to that character, you know, made you understand and you know, hold women in the hood, you know, as well as you would hold women outside of the hood, you know. So, you know, the Pointer Sisters were, you know, yeah, Pop, you're right. The Pointer Sisters were regal and classy with hankies in their hand. Yes, you know, even in that car wash scene, I remember, because they were talking to the Muslim brother, and tell him he's got to believe in something, with, of course, the legendary Richard Pryor. And that was one of my favorite scenes, because they just broke out in song and just, you know, I loved it. I loved it, as I still do. And just having it kind of sit in today's times, you know, if we look back, this music is so relevant. And that's what I'm talking about, having a legacy of music that will get you through times, because history will repeat itself, you know. And the reason why these songs are so relevant today is because anything, we all know, right? We all know that anything that you don't work out, you don't heal, will repeat itself.
And it comes, absolutely.
And it comes back bigger every time. And the history with race and racism in this country has never ever. It's always been swept under the rug, and it's always been like here, and nothing has changed. So my point is, what the hell do you expect to happen now? You know, we are in the middle of yet another race war. The racial pandemic has been going on forever, you know, and nothing is being done. So now it is all imploding, and it is global. And, you know, some things have to change. Not modify, not amend, change. You may have to scrap it and come right back with a new plan, you know, a new reform, you know, that works for the people, because the people are tired. The people have suffered long enough. We want all necks, all knees off limits. You know, we have to, and if you can't get it right, you know, like any other corporation, you may have to come in and wipe everybody clean and start it all over again. Because at the end of the day, the idea that we have to fight benevolent associations and fight, it's just sickening. And it shows how the mental health of racism in this country, been a lot of crazy going on a long time, long, long time, precedes me in life, but it long time. And, it's just no more. The people have had enough, and it's time for change. And that's it. And I'm not, you know, remember once upon a time when you would listen to the news, Jay, and it seemed like everything that you were listening to was fact, and there was such a format, you know what I mean? Even in your posture, there was a news carrier's format, there was a journalist's format, you know, that, you know, even in that tone of voice, there was a format for news. Right now, they are just a bunch of characters, you know. To see Don Lemon break the fourth wall is an amazing thing, and you know, and he's come a long way, and his his commentary too. I'm loving right now Chris Cuomo. Chris Cuomo is getting right at him, is asking the hard questions. And, you know, and I wouldn't mind seeing a brother team somewhere for the country, because they just ask the most appropriate questions. They interview everybody from the board to the curb, and their range of questions and antidotes, I'd be willing to give them a tag team shot. I'm just saying. Shout out to Andrew and Chris.
We've had some brothers do some things in the country before the Kennedys, right?
Yeah, we have. But I think they're the new Kennedys. You know, I really do. I really think they could be the new Kennedy tag team. You know, Andrew for his no-nonsense and transparent, relatively transparent approach to New York City government, you know, and has been. And I think that he is, when I speak to some people, my friends on the West Coast, they actually like his leadership. You know, he sounds like a stable voice. I've heard a lot. And Chris, you know, covering the landscape, has done an amazing job. Shout out to CNN for that, you know. And of course, you know, the White House clowns don't like him. So I love him for that. You know, and just stay there, you know, stay right on them, because, you know, and report the news from the people's perspective. But I really want to also remind people that all of these news outlets feed off of the people right now. They're all feeding off of our videos that we post, our videos that we send them, our commentary, our movement here. So they have lifted the movement of the street in a way that has not been done before. Because a lot of these clips that they're using, up to and including, you're gonna lose your job. You know, all of those come from the people right now. So they're helping elevate the people's movement, which I love, you know.
And just, we were talking about this last night, but just in case you didn't know, the mayor of DC has been sued by the people who are offended by the Black Lives Matter painting that she did on the street. They feel that that is showing favoring one belief system over another, that Black Lives Matter.
Mm.
So she's being sued for that, but I think that she knew that. You see, sometimes when you have a job, right, that has historically been done in a particular way, and you try, you get put in the position to do that job. There are systems, there are this and that, and sometimes you go along to get along, which I think that particular mayor did for quite a long time. Forget that. I mean, she is who she is. People do good, people do bad, and then sometimes people start to grow a little bit of a conscience and see what they can do the opposite way. You know, my question to people is, do we have space in whatever our movement is, our personal movement or collective movement, for people to change, for us to be accepting of when people show that they're starting to get it or being open to getting it, or, you know, damn, I can't even believe that I was a part of this. Okay. I need to strategically change. I need to do something to let people know I'm ready to change. When we see people or organizations but corporations or whatever make moves towards the right direction, when they have a history of doing some fucked up shit, we can't just say, okay, you're forgiving all your past transgressions. No. Okay, you did that. Now what you gonna do? And what else are you gonna do?
Mm-hmm.
Okay, this is what we need you to do. we have to be, I feel, and this is just me, that we have to look at steps forward as steps forward. Because we know also that every time there's a one step forward, they try to push us three steps back, sometimes four or five. But we have to catch the momentum of those positive things that happen and push forward from there. True. Let them know. Okay, you did that. Thank you very much. But we need more. Mm-hmm. Show me more. Mm-hmm. Mm-hmm. Because if somebody who's entrenched in the system or a corporation that's been benefiting from being a part of that system decides to step out of that at a risk to themselves, we have to then support them and help continue pushing them forward in our direction. Because the thing is if we don't support them, then they're going to fall back to where they get support. No, we're not supporting you doing this. We'll only support you if you do the bad thing, not the right thing. So I'm going to do the right thing, but I need some help and support. It's almost like putting Obama in the presidency, not giving him a Senate that's going to allow him to do the shit that he needs to do, or a House of Representatives, and then blame him for not getting shit done. You can't not support what it is that you want in a full way. We have to, and this is just my thinking. When we see people do something positive, we have to support that positive with all of our might and not just fall back. Does that make any sense?
I think I understand what you're saying.
What I'm trying to say. I don't think I articulated it well, but
no, I think I understand what you're trying to say. I just with that too, you know, I support that, you know, because I do believe in there's some, you know, we're talking about reform, right? So I think that, you know, corporations need a reform, if you will, themselves, you know, and for so long, you know, and like I say all the time, and I'm going to keep saying, you know, what we have by and large is a lot of corporations that contribute to the systems that oppress. Okay. But not oppress overall. They are disproportionately oppressing people of black and brown skin, you know, and that is it. So I think I want to rephrase some of what I said or frame it differently. And if you will, let's use the mayor of DC as an example. Like, I don't know what her agenda is. She hasn't made it public. You know, I just saw a yellow brick road and it was like, wow. So I can't interpret what she was thinking or what motivated that particular step, you know, that was done. You know, naming the street and naming the road was an amazing look. You know what I mean? It was amazing look, and it was in leading up to the White House. It was, you know, it was that thing. I'll give her that.
That spoke volumes.
But that being said, you know, and whereas I saluted and smiled at that effort, I can't say I know what motivated it. I can't say I mean, other than, you know, it being the truth, because it is the truth. But for her personal motivation, I don't know what she was seeking to do by doing that. You know, I don't know what's on her mind, what's on her political agenda. I just know what she has done thus far in DC, some of the things she's done thus far in DC. So I would love for her to step out and say, you know, this is the reason why, and here's what it is. And I bet that will be probably, unfortunately, it'll probably be public in a lawsuit, you know, and transcripts. But what is your ongoing agenda? Because that's sign and symbol. That's razzle dazzle flash. But what are the concrete changes, you know? Because DC needs a lot of them. And I know that she's entrenched just as everybody else in politics. I do not believe in politicians. I think they all have to lie and spin. You know, I don't believe in most of them, you know. But we're going to have to, for these people that run for these offices of representing the people, we're going to have to make sure they do just that, You know, we're going to have to make sure that they understand what the issues are. And the only way we do that is to stay in their faces and hold them accountable or get them out of here. I don't believe in these terms that a lot of folks have. You know, where in the country can you go and work somebody and fail miserably and stay in that position? You know?
Absolutely.
Because it's a term and how things have been cemented for this. You know, we've been traumatized for the last 4 years with this clown. You know?
Oh, definitely.
And why is he allowed to sit there? The whole impeachment process, and it's just too layered. And
because he's allowed to stay there because his people, his supporters, put in a Senate that would not remove him.
No, I understand. No, I get it. I get the mechanics.
But if we hired representatives that would have held him accountable, he would have been impeached and removed.
And see, that's what I'm talking about. The whole entire legislative. Thank you, body. From the Senate to the House, all of that needs to be wiped clean. And it needs to look like the people they represent. And by and large,
the thing though is that the people have to vote for people who represent them. If the Senate is full, they have two terms, mm-hmm. right? 2 years they get. It's been Republican. It's been the same nasty ass people. And they keep doing the same thing. I didn't vote for them.
Well, what I'm saying is I'm suggesting that the entire system, the way we get them there on down, needs to be dismantled and looked at.
You mean voting?
I mean the entire system, meaning from the House to the Senate, the way we get them there, how they're voted in, the practices, what the requirements are to be even in that seat, you know, which includes background checks on a lot of folks, because you're representing a massive bunch of people, a melting pot of people that all comprise the United States. It's just too many of us here for get rid of those wig wearing, gaffle holding, parliament looking folk. I think all the terms in the Supreme Court need to be capped at maybe.
Yeah, I think the Supreme Court lifetime thing, that's
ridiculous. It's absolutely ridiculous.
That's the thing I think that is just ridiculous.
Ridiculous.
Yeah, mm-hmm. I think that's ridiculous. But I think that what also needs to change is the electoral college. Senate, right. The length of a senator is 6 years.
Yeah, you know what I'm saying? 40. Yeah. Listen, you know, and that's a good point, Pop, and thank you. The term of the senator is 6 years.
But that's because the people keep voting them in.
Yeah, but you know, but how can someone make, and you know, and then when they leave, they have lifetime benefits. So it's interesting how, and listen, I know people that have gone over fought in wars, come home with nothing, and you're sitting there creating
situations
that bring us to war, and you get benefits beyond repair when you leave the office. You know, like, come on, man. This is like really bananas. This is really, really bananas. And it just does not make any sense. It does not serve the people. It was created to, we know why it was created. But at the end of the day, we're going to have to change up a lot of things. We really are. Because there's no reason for it. It's overhead heavy. All these bodies and committees to make decisions. Really?
I agree with you 100% that the whole system needs to be overhauled and changed and redirected. And unfortunately, I'm going to have to redirect our discussion right now on to Bonnie Pointer.
That's good.
We got to talk about Bonnie Pointer. And I was just reminded because Loretta Fuller popped up. And I actually, this is probably, well, not the first time, because I have reached out to Loretta in the past before.
Shout out to Coach Queen.
Yes, for different shows and, you know, for different things. Like, basically, at some points, it was like, Loretta, listen to the show real quick and tell me if it sounds or you could hear something or blah, 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 you know, and pop your right term limits would help prevent corruption and reduce the influence of special interests. I agree 100%. And for those of you who tuned in to hear about Bonnie Pointer, we going there right now. We going there right now. It's just that we are all on this show passionate about our lives, our country, our community, and what the hell is going on in this country right now. So we're very passionate about that, and we want change, and so we talk about it, and we always will talk about it.
Always will.
And that's just that. So, but also, we are also here to pay tribute to our legends. And we always say to our living legends, because we try to give them their flowers while they're here. And in the instance of Bonnie Pointer, we were able to do that. Ms. Pointer was initially on the show when I first started in 2014, November 2014, she was on the show. And that was the first time. And the most recent time, the last time she was on the show, was a month ago, May 2nd of this year. And so what we wanted to do was just play back some clips so you can hear Bonnie Pointer, her own voice. This woman just had the most amazing energy. And I don't want to hold Loretta up. So I asked Loretta to come on to the show because I was able to get this clip. So I want everybody to hear this. And this is the first year that I was doing the show. And it just shows how long Loretta has been a support to this show. I mean, just listen to this.
Pointer, how are you?
Loving what's your name?
Loretta.
Loretta, are you freezing there in Connecticut?
It's not too bad. It's not too bad. I mean, New England's so used to the cold, so it's not too bad. You know, I'll be booted and furred in a minute, so
I'm not too bad.
Yeah, it's not bad at all, but you
okay,
know,
if you say so.
Running around in the city, had to let y'all know I was listening in to you.
I am and, so glad you called in, Loretta.
Yes, yes.
What's your question?
Your music. No, no question. Just want to
no
let
question.
You know
just
that I truly enjoy
that.
Your music.
Well, what are you doing
and,
today?
Oh, I am tooling around, running some errands, and some friends and I are going to see Patti LaBelle in a few hours, so
get
I'm trying to get
here.
A few things done. And a little Downing, yeah.
Girl, she's gonna sing your feet off.
Yeah, she is. So I'm getting a little excited for that.
I know that's right.
Yeah.
So how was your Thanksgiving?
It was good. It was good. I had a lot of family in town. So it was about 25 people. So I ate and talked about the food, and then I continued to eat. But it was all good.
I know that's right.
It was all good. It
Take
was
a
all
nap,
good.
Get up, eat some more.
Yeah, like save me some extra ribs, the extra sauce, yeah. Mm-hmm. It was good, though.
Ooh, I'm getting
family's always
about
good
it.
To get together, so. All right, I'm not going to hold you long because I'm outside. Fire
well,
touches.
Well, thanks
up.
For calling, Loretta. Keep listening.
All right, I will. Oh, and Jay Vine, I'm like you. I can't sing, so we're going to find our key, and then we're going to rock a note, okay?
Yeah, okay. Well, okay. I'll
yeah, we'll work that out.
I'll just keep trying to talk to the people who really can sing and be, you
exactly,
know.
Exactly. Yeah. We'll play their music. Real well. That's
exactly.
It. That's
exactly.
It. All right.
I'll
have
a humble
now.
Thank you, Loretta,
you
for calling.
All right.
Great day. Okay.
Yes, that was Bonnie Pointer interviewing Loretta from Connecticut. So joining us now, and for some reason, Troy is not giving us his handsome face.
Well, the reason being is I just got out of the hospital. I had my surgery yesterday.
Oh, you did?
They did. Oh. They were able to move me in, and I'm not looking so great. So.
Oh, I'm sure you are beautiful. But I'm cool with it, Troy. I'm cool with it. I'm just glad
I still remember to call in.
I appreciate it so much. We love you so much. I do. I'm a Troy fan, a Troy Bronstein fan. And yes, Loretta's like, oh, I'm screaming over here. I will email you that clip, Loretta, if you would like. Of you speaking with Bonnie Pointer, and since you didn't have any questions, Bonnie was like, well, let me ask you a question. What are you doing today? And is it cold where you are? You know, she just had the most fabulous
energy.
Yeah.
It was a good time.
And Troy, I want to thank you so much for introducing me to her and so many other fabulous people, but specifically introducing me to her, because she was very not only entertaining and light and fun, but the way that interview with her went, I feel like
she's infectious.
Yes. And initially at one point she didn't like, because we know that Bonnie's done some wonderful things, and then she had some trouble, and then she was good again, you know? So I feel like there was a point during the interview she wasn't sure where I was gonna go. And you know I always keep it positive.
Right.
And I told her, I said, no, honey. Cause I said something and she said, oh my God, should I run? I was like, absolutely not. You're going to fall in love with me by the end of this show. Don't even worry about it. And I said, no, what I want to talk to you about was blah, blah, blah. When she realized who I was, she 100% cut loose, let it go, and was herself. And we had a marvelous time. And I learned something about hosting a show like this from her, which is, take care of my guest. Make sure that they know that they can trust me, and that I'm their friend. I'm an ally, and I just want to hear from them and give them their props. And when she realized what it was, and when I realized what I needed to do, we just had the best time. And I thank you so much, Troy.
Oh, you're more than welcome. More than welcome. I'm glad we were able to throw that last one in, because I remember when I was on the show, we were like, well, we have an opening in 2 weeks. Who are we going to do? And I said, what about Bonnie?
Exactly. And you know what? You've always been like, every time I reach out to you for guests, you're one of the first things you say is, well, have you had Bonnie on the show? Have you had Bonnie on the show? Like, you know, you're really like an advocate. You've always been an advocate for having her get some airtime.
Well, because she always got... You know, in my opinion, she always got kind of left out, you know, of the whole Pointer Sister thing. You know, she's the original one. Her and June started Point a Pair, which is what it was in the very beginning. And then from Point a Pair, then they added Anita, and then they became the Pointer Sisters. And then Ruth, who didn't want to join the group, the father made them all get together and become the Pointer Sisters. And so, you know, Bonnie ended up leaving the group to follow her solo career. She was the first one. They all did, actually, but none of them ever popped except for Bonnie.
Right.
And, you know, then it was just after that, I don't know what happened. I mean, it's the same thing like with Sister Sledge. The sisters all fight and they all have their, you know, different opinions and attitudes and stuff like that. But, you know, I've always been there for Bonnie. And, you know, I always felt that she never really got her justice. But, you know, towards the end, you know, she started to, and all the sisters, you know, I guess the older you get, the more you just realize, you know, this is, if you're about family, like I am, you know, family's first. I don't care about the money. I don't care about the publicity. I don't care about any of that crap. You know, I care about my family and the love that's there, and the love you give and the love you receive. And, you know, that's kind of how it started coming to end over the last like couple years, you know? And then now it's too late, 'cause she's just gone. You know, which is another sad situation. It all happened so fast.
Yeah. it really did. I mean, I couldn't get over it. We just spoke with her, and
she called me the day. She called me on Sunday to tell me how much she loved me and how much she appreciated everything that I'd done for her. And that was Sunday about 5-6 o'clock in the evening. Mm-hmm. And then 4 o'clock in the morning is when she got up out of bed to go to the bathroom, had a heart attack, and died.
Wow. I want you to listen to something.
You want me to what?
I want you to listen to something, okay?
Okay.
One of the things we're going to be doing today is doing a couple of snippets. So check this little piece out.
See, when I started off, I go, what do you call your lover when you want to get him in the sack? And they say, I call my lover Sugar Pie Honey Bun.
That's it.
Okay. I guess the Four Tops did that first, right? Yeah, the Four Tops.
Yeah. Mm-hmm. So, I mean, that whole sound, that whole era, the whole disco thing.
A couple of months ago, well, maybe last month, I was working with Thelma Houston and the really? Tramp. All those disco, they do those disco balls back east on the East Coast.
Wow, wonderful, wonderful. That must have been fun.
All the singers that I've, you know, always wanted to see, and I love their music. It's so good to work with them.
So you're still traveling and doing performances? You have not retired?
No way, Jose.
That's good to know. That's good to know. So do you have anything coming up soon that we should know about in the near future?
I'll be able to come and see you.
That would be great. I would love that.
Put the word out, girl. Put the word out.
Yes.
Sounds like a plan, girl.
Right? Why not? I'm going to talk to, and I have to, you know, thank my friend Troy Bronstein, who actually set it up so that I could interview you today.
That's my baby.
Isn't he wonderful?
He is so cool. I've been knowing him for years and just still love him. No love lost.
You know what? I mean, I've only, because it took me a long time to be able to reach that dude. You know, like every time I wanted to have a concert or do something and I wanted this artist or that artist, it was always speak to Troy Bronstein everywhere I went, and I couldn't find him. And now that I found him, I can't let him go. He's moving around a lot. You know, but not just because he know everybody I wanted to know, but because of who he is. He's such a sweetheart.
Yeah.
He's a really good guy.
Yeah, his family has a newspaper up there in San Francisco as well. They have a newspaper.
I didn't know that.
Mm-hmm. They've had it for years.
He's really nice, and
he's doing management and talent bookings. Yeah,
and the thing that's really great about him is that, you know, because you hear so much about artists being taken advantage of by their managers and promoters and so forth and so on, and he's not that guy. He's the guy that takes care and becomes friends with the artist and really cares for the artist, and that means a lot to me.
Yeah, he's real. He's real.
You know, good guy. And that's T. Best.
He's straightforward. He'll tell you like it is.
Oh, yeah.
Mm-hmm.
Yeah, I love it.
If you do something wrong, he will fuss real hard. Get you.
Yeah, I know. And that's why, I take care of you guys when y'all come in via Troy, because I don't want Troy getting on me. Why did you not?
Okay, no, you don't want that.
Yeah, no. So I'm going to make sure that y'all comfortable when y'all come to the basement.
Okay.
So, Troy.
Oh, my God. Yeah, you have to get me a copy of that clip. Oh, my God. That's funny.
Yeah. Especially the last part where she says, right? Oh, you don't want that. You don't want that.
You don't want that. Trust me.
Wait, but I did get a taste of it when she and Anita decided to call in. As opposed to do the video, Troy was. I was like, Troy, it was wonderful, wonderful, Troy. Oh man, but you know what? That's friendship. Like, come correct.
Yeah, I miss her. I miss her already.
Yeah, and, of course you do. How long have you known her, and how did you meet her?
I've known Bonnie. I met her. Oh my God. About the time I met Evelyn, actually. She had the track out, Bring Out the Beast. You Bring Out the Beast in Me. And, geez, I was 20 maybe. So 38 years.
Wow.
So it's been a long time.
Wow.
You know, we've both gone through our ups and downs, and we've both gone through them together. And, you know, I was going to say, we're still here to talk about it, but I am still here to talk about it. You know, it's been a long time. Long time. The marriage thing with Jeff, and that was, you know, a long time as well. You know, just the different things between the movies and the soundtracks and all of that. But she was always the one with the energy. You know, everybody always looked at Monty as the, you know, excited one, the one that always, you know, kept the party going, per se, or you know, everybody's involvement and their attitudes, because she was always so positive and so uplifting that, you know, you couldn't not smile or laugh when you were with her. You just couldn't, because she would say something off the wall or something that would just catch you and just be like, damn, you know, but you had to laugh, you know, because it was funny and it was just her character. You know, if she's telling a joke or if she was, you know, trying to be serious or adding to, you know, a comment or something like that. And, you know, she's talking about the shows, and she used to get excited when we did those shows, because she would get to see, you know, her, I say compadres, but her, you know, her people that she, you know, had music out with at the same time that she never got to see because she was touring herself. So she never got a chance to see them, and then having them all on one show, like the disco balls and stuff, you know, are great, you know, and she's developed a lot of friendships, you know, over the time with those groups, like Joy from the group Lime. I mean, they were very, very close. They both, Bonnie had a little small mechanical wind up dog. It was a little chihuahua, and she'd bring it on the road with her. And so, you know, she would have it with her when she would, you know, perform, and she'd have it on like backstage, and the dog would like take two steps and go like rough, rough, and then do like a flip. And so, Joy ended up getting a pink chihuahua, same type of thing, and went ahead, and the dogs became brother and sister. So as they were doing shows together, they both had their dogs. And it was funny. And it's just one of those things that, you know, it was another infectious situation where, you know, they would call each other and how's my baby doing? How's the dog? How's your cousin wants to talk to him? And they'd bark at each other over the phone and do stupid stuff like that. But, you know, you couldn't help but love her and the energy and everything that she brought forth. You know, she was there as soon as you got off stage. She would thank, you know, say, oh, you were great and great job. And, you know, that big smile and, you know, all that's going to be missed. It's going to be missed.
You know, you said something, Troy, about how she could say things that would leave you kind of stunned. I have to play this clip. I don't know how to describe it. So this is during an interview where by this time she's a little comfortable with me.
Uh-huh.
And we're just kind of chatting at this point.
What advice would you give somebody trying to break into the business now?
Stick to your heart. Stick with your heart. Your heart will tell you what's the right way to do things and what's right and what's wrong and what feels good to you. What comes naturally. Do what comes naturally. Don't try to force something on yourself that doesn't feel right.
Right, right, right.
That's the best advice I could give you, is to just stay true.
Mm-hmm. Yeah.
Stay true to yourself.
When you're listening to music these days, what are you listening to?
I listen to everything. It depends on the mood I'm in and where I am. I listen to everything because my taste is very eclectic. I like to do all kinds of music and sing all kinds of music and study all kinds of music. And that's another thing they should do, is study the history of the music that they want to do, or any kind of music. If you want to be in the business, you need to study the art and know your history, you know?
Yeah.
You need to know the past so that you can become the future.
Right, right. Mm-hmm. Exactly. Exactly.
You just recycle it and, you know, add a little twist and little turns to it. But it's, as long as it's beautiful and it sticks with you and it feels good inside to you and it makes you want to dance and smile and clap your hands, you're doing the right thing.
Exactly. Exactly. So are you working on any new music yourself, or are you just kind of relaxing right now, waiting for something new to come to you or hit you?
I'm always writing and working on new things. And, you know, you just have to kind of wait until it turns around and it feels like it's, you know, most of the things that I have are ahead of their time. So I have to wait for the world to catch up with me, girl.
I hear that. What's your song? what's your song? When were you born? What's your birthday?
July 11th.
That makes you a Cancer?
It sure does, every day of my life.
Uh-huh. So would you consider yourself to be emotional? So does that... Because they say that Cancers are watery and emotional.
Oh, they do, do they?
That's what they say, that, you know,
I'm feeling
very feeling.
Right now, I'm very emotional about this interview. I'm feeling dry. Okay.
I just love you. I love, love, love your spirit. But see, now I'm a Scorpio, so we're supposed to get along
Uh-oh.
Well. See? You see?
Uh-oh.
We're supposed to... Yeah, right?
Uh-huh. Tail all curled up.
Yeah, right? But I'm one of the good Scorpios. I'm a happy Scorpio. I'm not one of the dark moody ones. I'm one of the happy ones.
Yeah, we'll see about that.
Right? Wait till I get you in this basement and sing.
That's why you're down in the basement, huh?
Yeah, right. I know. Okay, so that's true. I am a little dark and swarthy, but I'm happy about it.
Okay,
you know?
Uh-huh. You like sticking people with that needle, huh?
Yeah, I do. Yeah, girl.
What is it called, that? Singer.
Yes, 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 yes. I kind of do.
Just throw a little sting in there and put them on their toes, right?
You know? So tell us one thing about Bonnie Pointer that the world doesn't know, or that the world would be surprised to hear about you.
Uh-oh. That's scary.
Yes. Oh, well, it could be.
I like dressing up in costumes.
Really?
Yes.
What kind of costumes?
Policeman, nurse, maid.
Really? That is interesting.
Yeah. Dominatrix.
Wow. Which makes your husband a happy man. Or your partner.
Myself.
Oh, you do that for yourself? Now that is
for
fun.
My friends. I'm not married.
That is fun.
Anymore.
Oh, right. Well, that is
no,
fun.
No, he has to go. Okay.
I hear that. Hey, he has to go. He has to go.
Sometimes, all right.
Sometimes they have to go. And that's just that.
Stayed a little bit too long. Don't say the welcome.
That happens. That happens. But I love that. So when I come to your house to visit you, you could be just dressed up as anything.
Never know.
Whatever you're feeling that day.
Mm-hmm.
Oh, my God. I love it.
Different, you know, different hair, different outfits. Yeah.
That is so fun.
Yeah, that's what makes it fun, to look in the mirror.
Yeah.
Like, oh my God.
Wow. You know, that I did not know that about you.
Well, and that's what you asked the question about, isn't it?
I surely did. Now I'm stuck because I don't think I have any more.
Oh, my secret is out. Oh my God. I'm gonna have to walk around with a mask on. Okay.
Well, that's fun too.
Oh, I do it anyway.
How about that? What do you like to do for fun? Now, you know, you done thrown me completely into a whole nother realm here, because I'm like, oh wow, Dominatrix Bonnie Pointer, wow.
Oh, correct, bad whip. Okay.
Yeah. Wow, just fun, just
well,
fun.
That's not the only. I don't have the whip all the time.
Yeah, I mean, well, you could, you know,
just
be the police officer. Police officer, ballerina,
yeah.
I don't know.
Mm-hmm.
I love it. I love it.
It's fun.
Yes.
It's always Halloween around my house.
And that is fun. Why not? Why not?
Halloween is every day.
And why not? You know, just live it.
And, you know, being the minister's children, we never got to wear a lot of things that the regular kids could wear, like nail polish and pants, you know. And, you know, so now I can just be the slut I was born to be.
You are funny. You are too funny. So, but, you know, bringing it back to your parents, you know, being ministers.
I'm getting spanked. I'm getting spanked.
Right now?
No. Okay.
Right now?
Wow. No,
you know, we have a show.
I didn't mean to say it like that. Okay, that's wrong.
But you know what? If you're getting spanked, you know, hey.
Oh, my God. That.
Wow. This is wow. You know, we have a show that comes on Monday evenings called the G Spot with Mika Ray. And, you know, I think our audience is just accustomed to just about anything. I don't even think Mika Ray has had anyone actually spanked live on the air. And so yay for me, because yeah, that's what's up. That's what's up. Bacon,
okay, you're
breaking
first.
Boundaries and spanking Bonnie Fletcher on the air. That's it. I love it.
I just had to share that with everybody.
Oh my God. Yeah, I know. Halloween was her favorite day, and it was almost every day. And that was one of the things that, again, about her, it's like, you know, we'd fly to the city we're going to, we'd check into the hotel and then have a little bit of time to relax before like sound check. And then I'd go get her for sound check, and I would never know what she was going to be wearing or what she's going to be looking like. She would go to sound check, you know, as somebody else, like big hair or short hair or, you know, red hair, green hair, blue hair. You know, it's just, you never knew what she was going to do. And she'd love dressing up. And then even when she was on stage, you know, she would never, well, I don't want to say she would never, because she has worn the blue hair on stage and stuff before too, but she would, you know, on stage be, you know, for the show would be Bonnie Pointer, and would have some elaborate kind of outfit on, wild colors or fur or feathers or, you know, something. But for sound check, she would always be somebody else. And then she would talk in a different dialect. Like, she'd be like, good evening, I'm too attractive to be captured. And, you know, she would talk and do stuff like that. And she's just like, stop it, you know? But, yeah, that's why I said it was always a laugh, and it was always fun, you know, traveling, you know, with her and doing the shows, because it was always just very uplifting and fun. I mean, there's no other word but fun, you know? So, but yeah, she loved to dress up, and you never knew what she was going to dress up in. Like she said, a nurse, you know, meter maid, sailor, you know, just whatever, you know, she'd have a sailor outfit with big, big, big old afro and a little white hat on the top, you know, just like crazy stuff. But gotta love her.
Absolutely. Let me tell you something. When she made that spanking sound, like she was getting spanked, she's like, oh, I'm getting spanked. And I heard this, I was like, I'm done. I don't think I ever have to do another interview with anyone ever again, because my daughter got spanked on my show. That's it, the end. What climax could you reach after that?
Right, exactly.
I saw you. I heard you kind of hesitate in your step, Javon. After that, you hear the clap, you hear the spank, and then you hear you go. That was the gag there.
You know, one thing, when my mind is right, I am never lost for words. I could talk anybody under a table. Get that from my grandma, but. Bonnie Pointer, you just want to listen.
Yeah, she'll throw you a curveball all the time.
Absolutely. Charlene Smith made a couple of comments saying, wow, Bonnie seemed to be a very happy, positive person. By the way, hello, Miss Smith. She said, for us to cherish our memories, everyone that knew and loved her. And she thought it was a sweet story about the dog. And Auntie Melba Moore says, hi, Troy. Bonnie was a hoot all night long.
See, Melba knows. She's been there. In fact, I'm looking forward to seeing you, Melba. Hopefully at the end of September, I believe it's still on. Melba and Evelyn are going to be doing a show at the O2 Arena in London.
Oh, nice, nice.
Hopefully that'll still be on. We're still waiting to find out, I think. So
that'd be very nice.
Yeah. So it'll be fun. It'll be good to see her again.
Absolutely.
Nice. What is one of, Troy, what is one of your favorite Bonnie stories, encounters that you've had? Something where you found yourself in thought, you know, about maybe some of her personality that stuck with you.
Oh my God. You know, there's so many. I can't even begin. They were all, I mean, every time you're with her, it was something different. You know, very seldom actually did I see her do or say, you know, the same thing twice. You know, she had that joke that she would do from time to time. I can't even remember, what it was, but she like tore up a napkin. You wouldn't see her, but she tore up a paper napkin and have it in her hand, and she'd tell a joke, something about a chicken and a chicken and a blowjob, and then she'd end up blowing into her hand and all these pieces of white napkins fly out in the air, and that was supposed to be like the chicken feathers, and everybody just like fell to their knees laughing. That was you know, it was just, she would do different things like that. And you know, even when she was serious, you would still just be like, you know, because you wouldn't really know if there was a joke coming behind it, or, you know, if it was serious. So there's too many to pick out one time. I mean, you've got over 30 years of havoc and fun, you know. I wish I could pick one, but I can't right now. Now you got me just now thinking, my head is going in a million different directions.
Right.
I'm trying to think of one thing, and what came to my head first was that chicken and the feathers. So
That's hilarious. In the most recent interview that we had with her, she was sharing a story about when, I think now I'm going to redact some of it, but I think she was sharing a story about when her parents were not, the transition from gospel to R&B, how the sisters would have these little mini concerts when their parents were out of the house. Remember that, Jay?
Yes.
And they would jump on the table, you know, and sing in the house when their parents weren't home. And I said, "Oh, Bonnie, you know, what were y'all singing?" And she said, she cut right to the chase. And that's when I got a glimpse of, you know, Bonnie being a good time, because she was like, "Oh, stuff we weren't supposed to be doing," or, you know, some response she had that was like, "Oh, okay, I got you," you know. But, she felt like a good time. You know?
Butter and jelly, picking our nose. Throw their dresses in their panties and pretend to do so.
Oh, there's many, many stories. Trust. I mean, that's all back in the day in Oakland. That was too much fun.
How is Anita? How's she doing?
Anita's doing good. She's doing good. You know, you have your good days, your bad days. Right now, she's totally devastated because her and Bonnie were best friends. You know, they spent a lot of time together over the last several years. And, you know, it's just that peace now is gone. So, I mean, it's devastating to all of us, but Anita's, you know, it's been really hard for her.
I'm sure.
Whew. But health-wise, she's doing much, much better. You know, and so all of that is positive, thank God. So,
yeah, please give her our warmest and sincerest hugs with
I will do that for sure. I will.
Yeah.
You could hear it in the interview. I swear I was trying to cut that interview up. All I was able to do was take out all of the beginning of what we were talking about before they called in. Mm-hmm. To start the interview, and I chopped out some of the callers so that we could just get to that, but I just didn't have enough time to really edit that video down to just Bonnie and Anita talking. But I do have a quick little snippet of Bonnie talking about when they were kids. So maybe we'll play that. Let's see. See
okay.
We have, and we welcome Miss Bonnie Pointer. Hi, Miss Pointer. How are you feeling?
Feeling fine, girl.
You sound great.
Thank you. I feel great.
You have, I mean, your energy comes through like one of your songs.
Oh, my God.
Yeah.
Feeling good.
I want to dance just talking to you. I'm just saying.
All right. We'll see what we can do.
You know what I'm saying?
Okay.
So how did you know, when did you first know that you had a voice, that you could sing?
Well, growing up, we were always singing around our house. My mom was always singing, and we were just kids making up songs about everything. We would make up the stupidest songs, you know, no matter what it was, peanut butter and jelly. You know, we'd make up something, you know, picking your nose, whatever it is. We'd make up a song about it.
Really? And were y'all in the church? Did you start singing in the church?
Both ministers in the Church of God, and we sang every Sunday. We would sing. We'd get a special request for the Pointer sisters to sing every Sunday. So my older sister Ruth would play the piano, and we'd gather around her and sing The Blood.
Wow, wow, wow.
That was our theme song.
Yes, yes. So who, outside of the church, because, you know, it seems as though most wonderful singers come from the church, but outside of the church, who were some of your earlier influences?
Well, I mostly liked people like Otis Redding, Wilson Pickett, Sam Cooke, Aretha Franklin, Gladys Knight.
Wow.
I like that hard R&B.
Yes, yes, yes. Well, you're talking about some real soul singers, you know what I'm saying? Like,
yeah, and I you know, I did like jazz, and I like the older singers too, like the jazz singers, like the Scatters, you know?
Yeah.
Lambert Henderson,
yes.
Ross.
Excellent.
The Andrews Sisters. And, you know, I like those kind of styles as well. Ella Fitzgerald, Sarah Vaughan.
Yes. At one point, you and your sisters were considered like the Black Andrews Sisters, because, you know, when y'all were wearing the 40s outfits and, you know, singing with
that music was just so fun and, you know, animated. It was just great to do. And the harmonies were so great and interesting, because instead of three, they usually had four or five or six part harmonies, even seven.
And what part?
It challenged your vocals. You know, it challenged you.
Yes. What was your part? Someone actually put that question out for me to ask you. What was your harmonic part?
Usually the fourth part.
You sang the bottom.
No, I sang like the weird jazz harmony.
Okay.
Three-part harmony is the basic chords, you know?
Right.
And you have to, and when there are four of you, you got to find your notes.
What a blessing. What a blessing.
So if you didn't want to get looked at really mean, you would find the note that wasn't someone else's.
Right, exactly. Yeah, right? I mean, I like to write songs, so I'm a songwriter, but I can hear perfect harmony, but I just can't sing it. I can't, my voice just won't do it. So I get that when I get looks.
You got to get on the note, girl. You got to jump on it.
You know, but maybe if I had some siblings that could
sing.
Don't
be above it. Be on it.
Exactly.
Okay.
So when you first became famous, I mean, really famous, when you heard your songs on the radio and you were doing movies, television, traveling the world, hit records. I mean, that must have been amazing for you.
It was crazy. We opened up, the first time we heard it on the radio, we were living in San Francisco. We opened up our windows and put our speakers facing the street so that everybody passing by our house could hear our record.
Wow. Wow. Yeah, I can imagine.
Yeah, it was a beautiful thing.
That must have been
it
something.
It still is. I still do the same thing right now.
Really? When you hear your music, you open up and you like, I'm Bonnie Point to everybody.
You never get enough. You never get enough. I'm spoiled.
I hear you. I hear you. But you deserve it. I mean,
you know, enough about me. Let's talk about me. No, just kidding.
I love it. I love it. I love it. I absolutely love it. You know, one of my favorite things is listening to some of your older cuts, and I always wondered what it would be like to be a Pointer Sister, you know, and to just be up there. What's some of your favorite memories? Like, what? Give us one thing that people may not know that occurred that really, really excites you, even when you think about it now.
Let's see. The thing that occurs to me is when the first time we went overseas to Japan or something like that, it was really fun. And we wanted to shop. You know, we were like racing with each other to get to the store first before the other one.
Yes, yes, yes.
No, like, my sister's coming and I got this first. Don't sell her the same thing, you know. So it was fun.
Wow. And when you first did your first overseas appearance, were you surprised that the fans over there loved you just as much as we love you at home?
Oh, yeah. It was just so thrilling. And we were, you know, just excited. And everything was going in such a spin. You really don't realize where you've been until you step back and look at it later on.
Mm-hmm.
You know, then you go back a few years later and you go, hey, I was here, you know, but I didn't get the chance because we were moving so quickly and so fast. Everything was just flying.
Wow.
We were so excited. We couldn't, you know, think straight anyway because we were
having fun.
We were just, you know, we couldn't believe it. We're in the dream world.
Yes. And you were so young. You were so young.
Well, we felt old because I guess it was those clothes, huh?
Oh. Well, you know.
We were old first. We're younger than that now.
Yes. Okay. I get that. I get that. Yeah. Sort of like going the opposite direction, right?
Yeah.
Growing younger.
Let me be first.
Yes, growing younger. I like that. I like that. We actually have a call. Let's take a caller right now. And
well, that's great that you got those memories and you've got those clips.
Yeah. So. It's special. And it's here for everybody, you know, forever.
Yeah. The archives, they will be in the archives.
Exactly. So Troy, if her family or anybody wants any of that, you know, of course, just let me know.
Yes, I will. I will. For sure.
You know, we have even more than that. We have the recording of her and Anita on our show when they're talking about celebrating June.
Right. Smells like June. They talk about the song Smells Like June. Yeah.
Yep. They spoke about the song. We played the song.
It's kind of catchy, isn't it?
Oh, it's really nice. I really enjoyed it.
Yeah.
They talked about future plans, unfortunately, you know, being in a museum and just a lot of stuff, you know?
Yeah, there was a lot of stuff happening. There's, you know, they're looking at a movie and a book and all this stuff now. And now, you know, it's going to just be different. You know, so, but it's all good. Yeah. And if anybody wants anything, I'll definitely let you know.
Yeah, we actually even have a clip of her doing impersonations as well.
Oh my God.
you know how she was.
That's what I mean. I mean, you never know. She would come up with this stuff and you would laugh. I mean, you know, it'd be like one of the, you know, we'd all get our asses chewed out or something by a producer or something. And you're kind of like, you know, walking on eggshells and she'd come up with this, or she'd come out and talk like somebody else and do an impersonation and would just break the moment to where you weren't feeling bad anymore. You know what I mean?
Yeah.
She was great about that. So, yeah.
Yeah. Just wonderful. So I'm glad that you finally got your surgery. I'm happy that happened. I hope you start to heal well and soon.
Yeah, I've got my therapist coming in about 8 minutes, so I'm gonna have to say goodbye here shortly here. And then I only freaked out one time because this is my first, like, outside of my tonsils. I mean, I'm 58. I've never had any surgery. And I don't even like getting my blood taken. It makes me, you know, I'm a big old baby. So, you know, when they were doing this and then they gave me the spinal tap and I couldn't feel my legs, I freaked out. I was screaming and yelling. I'm like, I can't feel my legs. Ah! And everybody else that was in the waiting area to go in for surgery, I must have scared them all to death. Six of them to hold me down. And I was like, get me out of here.
Oh, you know?
It was, and then, you know, I woke up and it was over and I still couldn't feel my legs, but it didn't bother me then, you know.
How are you doing now?
I'm fine now. I'm over at my best friend's and they're, you know, because they have to have 24-hour care for the first week. And so it's like every 20 minutes I'm being iced and I'm getting my pills on a routine, you know, basis. And I'm kind of spoiled. I'm just laying here in the bed watching TV, having pills and ice packs and food.
Right. Good. Enjoy it, man. Enjoy it.
The best part, though, is I don't have any more pain. That, like, ice pick in where it was just like someone stabbing an ice pick in your hip, that's gone. So now it's just soreness, and I can handle that.
Right. You
know, because of having that pain, it's just I don't know how to act without it. So I'm very, very blessed and happy that everything went well and I can continue on now. I can tear up the dance floors again. Like, Evelyn's waiting. Dance floor. She's like, I want to dance with my brother again.
Excellent. Please send her our love and let her know that we're waiting for her to come back on the show as well.
Okay. All right. We'll set something up. No worries.
Yes. We have a lot of flowers to give her too.
Yeah. And you guys have a wonderful day. I'm glad I could call in and contribute to the lovely and Miss Bonnie Pointer. So. And I didn't cry, so that's a good thing.
Yes. Love you to pieces, Troy. Take care of yourself. Speedy recovery,
Troy. Speedy recovery.
Thank you. Thanks, guys. Thanks, ladies. All right. Talk to you later. Love you both. All right.
Thank you. Bye. That is the prince among queens. I'm telling you, he's a great guy. Troy Bronstein. Great guy. Yeah, I didn't realize that he had had his surgery. I knew he was coming up for the surgery, but I didn't realize that. And for him to do this while he's so soon after surgery is just amazing. You know, really love that guy. Really nice.
Yeah, he's a trooper, man.
Absolutely.
It's got to be hard, man. Just somebody that you've been working with and you love for that period of time to suddenly can't imagine. And again, I just want to send our deepest condolences to the Pointer family, specifically to Anita as well. It's rough. It's really rough. So that's two sisters and that have gone
especially on. When it's someone like Bonnie Pointer who brings such an energy, laughter, spontaneity, you know, especially during a time when the world is so dark, to have someone so light and fluffy, you know what I'm saying? Personality, you know, she's just fun. And I don't know. I was so saddened when he told me that she was gone. That really made me sad, of course, but because she was kind to me and she just that personality. Personalities like that don't grow on trees. No. You can find the fun piece in everything.
Right.
A lot of grumpy people out here.
For sure, you know. For sure. And like I said, her. I'm sure that June is there waiting, wrapping her arms around him. But shout out to Ruth, to Anita, to Issa, to Sadeko Pointer. And it's rough. It's a rough one, you know, just lifting them in spirit and in love and light around the transition of Bonnie.
Absolutely. Oh, and let me just do this. You all have to hear this, and then we'll play some music. But I would be remiss if I didn't play just a little bit more of the fun of Bonnie Pointer.
I was watching a clip of you on. No. This is a good clip.
Did I run?
No. Don't you go anywhere. Matter of fact, okay. You're going to fall in love with me today. That's my goal. Have you feel so comfortable that you want to come and chill with me in the basement just for the heck of it.
So why not?
You know what I'm saying? Why not? Okay. Just chit-chat and talk about you and more about you. That's what I want to do. I don't know. So... I saw a clip of you and your sisters on Soul Train, mm-hmm. and you did a really good impersonation of Esther Williams. This is a long time ago. Do you remember that show?
Did I do that on there?
Yes, you did.
I must have been out of my mind.
No, you did a great job. You really did a great. So, and they were asking you if you wanted to do an impersonation of Cher, and you said no. You would prefer to do Esther Williams. So, I'm just wondering if you are like known to do impersonations. Do you still do impersonations, or was that just a?
I do them when I, you know, called upon to do them.
Really? Which was an invitation, you know. I didn't get it though.
Before we got signed to a record company, we used to sing backgrounds with her.
Oh, I didn't know that.
Mm-hmm.
So. You did background for Esther Phillips, and who else?
You want to hear her?
Yeah, that'd be great.
You know you do.
I did kind of bring it up. But. Yeah.
Okay, please. Here's her. Here's the one I do. Now I got a cold feeling. Then it's like ice around my heart. I got a cold feeling. Then it's like ice around my heart.
Wow. Excellent. You sound just like her.
Okay. Scary, isn't it?
Yes, it is. Gee. Now, who else do you do that you know, really well? Who else do you do?
A little Cher. Okay. Clap your hands.
I love it.
That's it.
Wow. Well, I you know what? I gotta do this for you. Hold on. Where is my clap? Where are the people that clap? I have some people. There they go. Some people in the basement that clap.
Oh, they clap. Okay. Here they go. Clap.
Well, I just want to say that I enjoyed every moment speaking with her. I am going to create, I guess, I'm going to put together pieces of the first show with our show. And then I'm going to put it up on the podcast so that anybody who wants to hear Bonnie Pointer, they can just go to the podcast and they can hear those pieces that I played from the first time I met her, and then with some edited things from when you and I spoke with her and Anita. And that will be, excuse me, available to everybody probably by tomorrow. Because when I start something, I have to finish it. And I started editing our show. I just didn't get time to chop it up. Yeah. But she was lovely. There's a lot of vintage footage of her and her sisters online. I hope everybody checks it out. Let's continue to send love and healing their way.
Did they have services for Bonnie already?
No, not yet.
Okay.
Not that I'm aware of anyway. Because I saw where Anita was saying that they're trying to find a way to, you know, celebrate her in a way that's befitting. She, you know, actually, since I've been doing any kind of show like this, she's the first one to have passed. So I'm not really sure. I just hope that we pay tribute to her in a way that she would have appreciated. I think she would have, just, you know, playing her from her own lips.
You know, I think it comes, this falls right back on, and the reasons why we do what we do, you know, it is to, and to reiterate, we are giving people flowers while they can smell them. You know, it's important to honor and lift beyond the music, you know, the individuals. Because then when you understand the individuals, or you get to know the individuals behind some of the music, you'll understand what motivated a lot of the songs, you know, what motivated a lot of the energy. And, you know, I just believe that music and sound in its own right is very, very soothing, and it heals us. And ministers of music that are anointed with these voices that carry the message, you know, they can also carry a lot of other things, you know, in their spirits that they move with that too. You know, like they say, comics, the same deal goes for comics. A lot of comics are depressives, but they are, they make us laugh, and they could be experiencing or feeling something juxtaposed to what they're actually doing for us. You know, there's a cleansing of sorts that goes on. And, you know, when you meet personalities like Bonnie Pointer and Chaka Khan and Whitney Houston and so many, Aretha Franklin, you know, having encounters with all of those women, you know, either in person or privately or publicly, you know, some of their personalities pop through, you know, you get that. And it's, and they can tell you stories and motivations. I remember sitting with Aretha Franklin and talking with her about some civil rights stuff. And she had her very, very unique perspective on things, you know, because she had spent some time in she didn't like to fly, but she had spent some time with some folks that I knew from Tennessee. So that was like listening to her drill down on that, you know, in a real family kind of way, you know, you just, those moments are precious, you know. I didn't know Bonnie personally, but I can say that what I gathered from you and from talking with her and from Troy and from Anita, you know, it she just was one of those spirits, you know, just one of those spirits, and she will be greatly, greatly missed. And also just makes you wonder about all the folks that have transitioned. Like, if you, you know, depending on what your individual belief system is, like, because, you know, we only know this life, right? And you know how arrogant man is, you know, we think that this is all it is. And when you leave here, that's it, you know. But for those of us who don't believe that death is final, it's final carnally, like we can't touch the person. But I do believe that there's another realm where, you know, there's just stuff going on, and we're going to be, everybody's here, left carnally, is late for the party, you know, because they start their journeys on the other side. And whatever that is, we salute you, Bonnie Pointer, for making the world a better place here through your music, through your talent, your gregarious personality. You know, thank you for the laughs and the soundtrack of many of our lives. We appreciate you.
Absolutely, absolutely. Therese, tell everybody how they can follow you, where they can find you.
Ubiquitous. Okay, you can find me on Facebook, Twitter, and mostly Instagram. You know, these days it's Therese, T-E-R-E-Z, M as in man, Y-C-H-E-L-L-E, at Instagram, Twitter, and Facebook.
That's right. And we are in the basement with Javon and Therese on Facebook. I am Javon on Twitter. We're also WJBR Internet on Twitter. In the basement, or is it brunch in the basement? I'm not really even sure, damn it.
In the basement.
In the basement with Javon and Therese on Instagram. I think that's it, right? Oh, also check out our website, www.wjbrinternet.com. Check out the 24-hour broadcast where you can hear all this music and so much more. You never know what you're going to get, so be careful with the kids around that radio station. It's just a bunch of fun. And let me see. What else? Oh, check out our wares at our merchandise. When you go to www.wjbrinternet.com, you can get t-shirts, mugs, etc. And if you do purchase, which someone just made some purchases of some things, including something for a child, which I thought was pretty cool, send us pictures so that we can post the pictures up on the website. As you peruse the website, you will be able to see some of the faces of the people who have been there. You will find some videos of hours that we have done, interviews, and some of the artists there, and just some other groovy stuff. So www.wjbrinternet.com. You know, go check it out. It's not up yet. I have not updated, actually, our schedule for the rest of the month. I have not even had an opportunity to change our artists of the month, but I'm hoping that this weekend I'll have some time to update the website. But I will tell you this, that this coming Wednesday, you definitely want to set aside time to check us out, because our special guest is going to be none other than Shanice. I love your smile.
Yay, we have Chris on the show.
And yeah, it's gonna be a stone blast, a stone blast. And we're gonna have the following Saturday is going to be Therese and her wife.
Pause. Get back at you.
We're gonna pause that. We'll let you know. Stay tuned.
But we may have some representatives for the movement, which is known and caused and causing quite a stir right now, called By the Block Back. So By the Block Back, you need to hear from some of the representatives of By the Block Back. So we're looking forward to that.
Okay, so we'll let you know what's going to happen next week. And hopefully I'll know when we get there. Everybody have a good time. And we're gonna end it with, I'm just going to play a little Bonnie Pointer. We just going to play a little Bonnie Pointer. And
Shout out to Missy Dawn, Charlene Smith, Pop, and P. Miller in the building.
Pegster.
The Pegster.
Everybody, enjoy.
Hi, this is Bonnie Pointer, and you're listening to Brunch in the Basement with Javon.
Interest.
Thank you so much. And I want to thank you again for coming on the show, for calling in, and for being such a delight. You're such a pleasure. You are
thank
such
you
a
so
pleasure.
Thank you so much, Javon. It's a pleasure interviewing with you. Doing
and
the interviewing.
Yes, yes.
Talking,
and with that,
how about that?
Yes, right? Talking, laughing, and sharing stories. It's been
okay.
A blast. It's been
show.
A stone cold blast.
Let's
all right.
Go. Let's go,
Lee, my Rolly. Oh, my goodness. Thank you so much. Thank you, thank you,
you're
thank
welcome.
You.
And thank you and for with, calling me, and I appreciate it.
And with that, heaven must have sent you. God bless, and keep making it do what it do, and we're going to stay in touch.
Okay, for sure.
All right, baby. And
thank you. Bye, everybody.
Bye. And for all of y'all listening, remember that God loves you, and so do I. Be worthy
yes,
of the bullet that's coming to get you.
Okay.
Have a great weekend.